I came here when I was 12 years old. My parents didn't exactly tell me that I was coming into the United States. Our mom just told us, you're not going to school today, don't worry about it. We're actually gonna go see an aunt. It's gonna be a short trip. You can just say bye to grandma and grandpa. We're gonna be back. The last thing I remember from leaving Mexico was that my grandpa was sitting in a chair. He waved us goodbye. My mom just told us, oh, we're gonna get into this bus. It's totally gonna be fine. Just ignore whatever they're saying. Don't worry about it. We got into the bus. I remember, well, from past trips when I was little, that it takes only one night to get to Mexico City, to where we were headed at. But we've been in the bus for 2 days. I was like, Mom, where are we going? Where are we? Then she sat me down and she was like, you know what? I have to tell you the truth. You're not gonna see your grandparents again. We are actually not going to live in Mexico anymore. We're gonna go to the United States. The next day we got into this van with a bunch of people that were crossing that day. They gave us a bag full of food for our trip. We were supposed to walk for 4 hours. I remember that at a point we saw human bones. I told my mom, look at that, what is that? That looks like bones, that looks like a person's spine. So I remember seeing a hill full of crosses. I didn't even ask my mom because I instantly knew that that's where a bunch of people passed away. I remember asking my mom, so where is this border? Like, why are we walking for so much? She was like, well, we're already in the US. It's just that, you know, we still have to walk a little bit until we find the house. When we got into this really small house, there was a bunch of backpacks, a bunch of letters, a bunch of little stuffed animals of people who had been there before. The person who was crossing us told us to leave our bags, to not even think about taking our bags, to just leave everything behind. Now that I'm here, I'm definitely grateful for what my parents did. They came here because they wanted a better life for me, my brother and sister. My dad thought of us first, rather than thinking about his own life. It's not as just walking over a border. That's not how things work. They really risk their lives.
Good afternoon, Immigrant Law Center.
We've literally helped tens of thousands of people settle in Minnesota. We've created the equivalent of towns of new Americans in Minnesota.
One of the things that we know is that immigrants bring a huge contribution to our state.
What immigrants bring to Minnesota is the ability for Minnesota to really truly be a part of a global community.
At every level of the economy, immigrants have become a key part of Minnesota's workforce.
We're not a burden. If anything, we bring a lot of talent, a lot of resilience, a lot of assets to our communities.
The world of Immigrant Law Center starts with three people around a coffee table and trying to figure out how do we keep serving our community.
ILCM began as this tiny, struggling offshoot of a major nonprofit.
Back in the 80s, Southern Minnesota Legal Services, or SMRLs, had satellite offices. And there was a satellite office in the old neighborhood house on the west side of St. Paul. We affectionately called it Oficina Legal. And SMRLs had one attorney there doing immigration work.
Congress had worked its way to get a change in the law in a large bill where they couldn't use legal services money for immigration matters. We'd always been involved in immigration matters for 15 years up to that time at Smurls, but it just stopped.
And so Smurls was in a real dilemma because they had a lot of private funding, they had a lot of federal funding. And all that summer of 96, we discussed, and finally it was decided that Smurls would break off the immigration unit.
We literally were sitting around a table trying to figure out how to be an independent organization and no longer just the neighborhood office of a much larger organization.
We had a dilapidated building. I'm telling you, it was so bad, it was gonna fall down around us. I'd walk around there wondering when it was gonna collapse.
We realized that we needed to have an entity that would live into the future as an independent nonprofit, and so we're very strategic about picking the name.
I know we have law in our name, and law is central to our services, but Immigrant Law Center is so much more than that.
Over the last 20 years, seeing the growth of ILCM has just been a very impressive case study in organizational growth, but also in organizational responsiveness to community.
Now Immigrant Law Center, you know, it kind of grew into the dream that we had 20 years ago in terms of advocacy, education, outreach, serving the whole state and serving all communities.
I support Immigrant Law Center because I lived it. Back on, I believe it was December 13, 2006, about 3 o'clock in the morning that day, they came out and they stormed JBS meatpacking facility here on the outskirts of town. I got a phone call from our steward at the time. His name was Paige Lira, who told me, "Mike, you need to get out here. They got immigration is out here, and they've got guns, military-style weapons, face masks, shields, and you need to get out here." Later on that afternoon, kids were getting out of school and, of course, would come home. Kids would go into their homes, and their parents weren't there. I mean, they'd wait and wondering, "Where's my mom and dad?" So, of course, during the whole course of all of this activity going on and people being rounded up and handcuffed and loaded up on the buses, I'm thinking in my mind, who could I call for some help?
Immigrant Law Center was one of the first on the scene to help those families work through the law and the emotions that came with it.
ILCM was just a critical player, and nobody else could have performed that service here in the community. And so they fortunately were willing to kind of be flexible and come down and include Worthington as part of their service area.
The Worthington raids significantly changed the work, although we'd been headed to rural Minnesota at intervals and saw that certainly as our mission. The raids, the swift raids in Worthington, really solidified our work there because we were called to do that work.
The need for helping families stay together was so critical, and we ended up opening an office there.
What are two rights in the Declaration of Independence?
I think the work that the Immigrant Law Center does here in our community is so important because it's filling a gap. We've been partners with the Immigrant Law Center of Minnesota for many years through community education, and currently we partner with them on providing services to refugees. We also collaborate on providing citizenship classes to help people in the process of pursuing U.S. citizenship. It's just been a really rich and rewarding kind of experience to live here in this community.
So it's so easy to be an advocate for ILCM.
When I think of ILCM, it's extraordinary, the degree of impact that you've had and that you've been able to attain in 20 years.
It's a place for individuals to go where they can seek answers and assistance if they need it, but it's also a way for individuals such as myself, local elected officials and others, to understand what the true issues are.
I welcome the advocacy that the organization brings to the legislature, the perspective, and clearly that's not happening only here at the state capitol in St. Paul, but also in Washington.
People call my office to help them handle all kinds of things. Veterans benefits, Social Security, housing, but the number one issue people call us to help them work on is immigration. So when I got to Congress, you know, I relied on John, I relied on ILCM for advice on a whole range of things.
The services provided by the Immigrant Law Center touched the lives of countless Minnesotans. Your 20-year commitment to justice and equality ensures that people of our state enjoy due process and a greater measure of fairness as they navigate our broken system.
I want the Immigrant Law Center of Minnesota to continue their fine work, to continue educating all of us on the best policies, and then also helping those individual citizens, which sometimes can be the most rewarding.
We served people from 110 different countries last year, so more than half the world's countries have arrived in Minnesota, and we do an intake with them. If we can help them, we know that we are changing their lives.
When you make an actual difference in someone's life, that kind of speaks to me at a really high level.
At the end of the day, when we help them, I mean, you can't put a price on the smile on their faces.
The Immigration Law Center have been such a great help, and it's still been being a great help.
It's unified thousands of families. It's the reason why I'm a citizen now. It's the reason why I'm going to vote, you know, and it's the reason why many people are in that same situation.
This country. My dad loves this country. Coming into the United States has never been taken for granted.